let's begin the afternoon session. It's going to be Terry. And the first speaker is Fermín Moscoso del Prado Martín. He will speak about language acquisition, dynamical system, and causality.
First of all, I'd like to thank Kumiko, Ramon, and especially Gukas for three things. First of them, the three of them for organizing this wonderful meeting. Gukas for being the local organizer, which I'm sure has been a lot of work. And the third, congratulations for Gukas is for being actually able to pronounce my full name. This is something that hardly ever happens. Now, I'm going to be presenting stuff mixing quite a lot of domains, so there's going to be a little bit of dynamical systems, a little bit of information theory, and a little bit of language acquisition. That means that at some point many of you will need to interrupt me. Please feel free to do so. I think now with a little bit of cutting I've been doing, I should be able to fit everything in time, including interruptions. I almost promise this. I work in the Department of Linguistics, although I'm also affiliated with psychology and engineering, and I like to consider myself a kind of a scientific tourist and do a little bit of things here and there. Basically, I'm somebody who, if you give me data, I get very happy, and then I get really excited, and if you give me data and a question, I get double happy. So I'm not really, I'm saying this because I'm not really a specialist in language acquisition. This is actually the first work I've ever done on it. And this is joint work with two amazing, is actually an understatement, students. So these are two undergraduate students of mine that are now Jeremy Irving, who's now a master's student at Stanford Computer Science, and Daniel Spokojny, who's going on now to the PhD program in computer science in Carnegie Mellon. These guys were responsible for doing a lot of the calculations in this work, and they were really very important contributors of this work. So I'm gonna be looking at how children learn language, and of course, when you look at how children learn language, there's a few trivial things. So if you look at how children learn words, there's almost no debate. Every single person agrees that children learn the words of their language. No big deal. However, when we go into syntax or grammar, first of all, there is hardly any agreement on what grammar actually is. So probably if you put 10 linguists into a room and you ask them what is grammar, you get 20 theories and a few fights. I don't want to get into any of those fights. But we can't simply, being very simplistic, say that at least a part of the grammar of a language, there is more parts that I'm not covering here, one of them should concern inflection, and inflection is how you can change words to put them into different contexts. And another should concern syntax, at least understood as how we can order those words in order to form sentences that have different meanings. There's additional parts of syntax, of grammar I'm not even covering, not even talking about. So think about intonation, which is something that we are paying quite a lot of attention to in Santa Barbara, and many other layers. But just allow me to keep this very, very simplistic approach. And even when you go into these very simple things, what you find is that there is huge disagreement in the field on how do inflection and syntax get to be there in children. And you could typically split this into two very broad schools of thought. And as you know, somebody once was telling me that psychologists, with regard to their theories are a bit like toothbrushes. So no self-respecting psychologist will use somebody else's. That means that even if they have the same theory, they will give it a different name to create a new theory. So you have basically two schools of thought. One you could call a nativist school, in which language is not learned and it's there, and it only requires some degree of activation or fine-tuning in order to put it to work. And you have what I call usage-based theories. Again, they come under many, many, many different names. And the basic thing is saying, well, there is nothing so special about syntax. Syntax has very much to do with lexical knowledge, and the kind of processes that are going on for acquiring syntax are the same kind of processes that are going on for acquiring the lexicon, whatever those are. I'm ultra simplifying here. As you know, if you've been following these debates, this gets into really, really bitter debates in conferences over sometimes very relevant details from my point of view. Now, for me the important thing is that these theories actually make predictions. And among these predictions, some of them have evidence, there is at least substantial evidence supporting several of these. One of these is what people tend to call the lexical basis of syntax, meaning that in order to learn syntactic structures, first you need to learn sufficient words that afterwards you can actually combine to begin building these syntactic blocks. And there is a lot of work from Elena Levin's group showing that this appears to be the case. On the other hand, you have also what you could see as the reverse. I call it, this is not a standard name by any notion, the syntactic basis of the lexicon. Some other people will talk about syntactic bootstrapping. And this is the idea that actually it's not as simple as you learn the words and then you learn the syntax based on them, because there are the meaning of some words you cannot ever guess if you don't know some syntax. Two particular cases of these are verbs. To understand the relational meaning of verbs, you need to have some idea of the syntactic functions of the slots of those verbs. Other typical examples are abstract words. So in order to understand the meaning of an abstract word, you are going to have to understand its relationship to other words that are around it. Another important prediction is that if children are actually learning grammar from their input, their social context is going to matter a lot. So different children exposed to different inputs are actually going to develop different languages. And those individual differences should be observable and predictable from measures of the linguistic environment in which the children are. And there is evidence that there are strong correlations between the language that caretakers use and the language that children use. And another one that's, for me, the most important point of what I will talk today, as you know, there has been for a long time a debate about what some people have called motherese or child-directed speech, in the sense that children in most cultures, I mean, Pinker would claim that there are some cultures where that doesn't happen, but for what I know, that's actually not true. Children are not exposed to the full complexity of language. They are exposed to simplified versions of their homeland, of their native languages, so their mothers and parents typically speak a simpler language to them. And that complexity increases with time. And one hypothesis, there is evidence, but I think the evidence is not solid, that seems to indicate that this is good for children. And what mothers are doing is that as their children are growing, they're adapting the language they use to what they know their children are able to do. So there is a dynamical process going on by which each mother is fine-tuning the language she uses with the child in response to the child's development. And this brings a very important thing. So if we are thinking of language acquisition or language development in general as a dynamical system, we really cannot consider children in isolation. At the very least, we need to consider children with their most important source of linguistic input, that's their mother or their parents. Now, what facts are there around? The first is that, as opposed to what many people have said, if you read Pinker, you believe that children are bloody geniuses, but in reality, children are actually much less creative than generative linguists have been telling us they are. They're basically parrots. And Thomas Edelman and Elena Levin have actually shown that every single utterance that a child produces until a certain age has literally and exactly been produced by their parents in the past. Something pretty radical. So when Pinker is telling us that children are very creative in the way they use rules, they're actually not generalizing that much. They're very much repeating what they have already heard. Deb Roy at MIT, and also with a huge sample, reaches very, very similar conclusions. We also know, and Liz Bates did a lot of work on this, Liz Bates is my all-time hero, so I always, in every talk I give, I reference her. And she found that there is clearly a lag between the generalization of syntactic structure and lexical acquisition, indicating that syntactic generalizations tend to happen after a sufficient amount of lexical items have been learned. And for a very long time, and we have known that child-directed speech is simpler, and I know simpler is another term, especially in this room, but in any kind of measure you would get of it, the entropy of it, its vocabulary size, the number of syntactic structures, you'll find that they're much reduced with respect to adult speech. Picker would say that there is a few groups, particularly African groups, that in which children are not exposed to simpler input, they're just not exposed to input at all. People that have looked into those claims in detail find that that's actually not quite true. And there is evidence, in particular, Sokolov had some, I think, pretty convincing evidence that children seem to benefit from having this reduced input. And this also anecdotically fits into old modeling work using neural networks on language, showing that when neural networks are learning sequences, they're actually learning those sequences better if you are presenting the examples in an increasing complexity way. So you start with simple examples and you make them more and more complex. So all of these things seem to support, to a certain degree, the idea that grammar is learned. So not so much in the generative linguistics approach, but much more so in the usage-based approach. However, there is a problem here. Many of these claims that I have made are actually causal claims. And all the evidence I have shown you before was correlational. What do I mean by this? Well, when we're saying that the lexical basis of syntax, I'm not just saying that there is a correlation between lexical items and syntactic development. What I'm saying is that syntactic development is happening because there was lexical development before. And this word because is very important. Because what we're meaning is that there is actually an arrow of causality there that we cannot prove with purely correlational methods. Same thing when we say, well, if children are benefiting from fine-tuning, then what we're saying is that their language is simpler or more complex because their parents were simpler or more complex. So it's not just some genetic correlation that they just happen to have simpler or more complex language. Is literally a response, a direct response to what they have been exposed. Again, this needs to be proved causally. Same with fine-tuning. And fine-tuning can be divided into two hypotheses. On the one hand, you have people that would say, well, that's what you would call strong fine-tuning. Mothers are actually paying a lot of attention to the specifics of their children's language and are adapting their language in response to their linguistic abilities of their child. On the other hand, you would have a weaker version that several people defend. You say, well, actually, mothers don't really care that much about what the children know in terms of language. They are just paying attention to the overall level of development of the child. So we know, well, it's roughly a bit older, we should make this a bit more complex and so on, without actually paying attention to the language. This should be distinguished causally. So if you can find that there is a causal relationship between the language of the child and the mother, you are discarding the weak fine-tuning hypothesis. It's not about the age of the child. It is literally about the language they've been exposed to. And, of course, whenever I present this, especially psychologists tend to be a bit annoying when you tell them these things, because every psychologist has been hammered since the first year in university that it's impossible to do causal inference if you don't do an experiment. They will tell you this over and over and over again. And I have to convince them, actually, your experiments are not much better than observational data in many respects. And observational data should be good enough to draw causal inferences. If you use your statistics right. By the way, as I remember, Professor Hamlatsi was saying that he doesn't use BBC English. I don't either. So if at any point you don't understand me, please make me repeat. I'm famous for speaking too fast, even in Spanish. So, and that's where dynamical systems can actually be of help. There's been a lot of work from different groups, and in particular there's two groups that I particularly like what they've been doing. On the one hand, you have Paul von Heyert in Groningen, that for many years has been proposing that you can model language development and the interaction between children and parents using systems of coupled of couple differential equations. On the other hand, you have the work of Rick Dale that also finds that children and their mothers form single dynamical systems. And you could think that at a what you could call a computational level, in Marx's sense, you could use these systems of couple differential equations to model the co-development of a child language and the mother's language in a very similar way as you would do in a predator prey system. And what you find is that this, when you have these nonlinear equations, you sometimes get very, very complex patterns of development in the system that could seem or even be chaotic, but are nevertheless ultimately deterministic. And I think this is important because basically what, by saying these are deterministic to a certain degree, what we are saying is that this is a natural process that irrespective of differences of what's happening in one child or another child, we have one single system in all children that they are benefiting from that same system. And nicely, the techniques nowadays tolerate a fair amount of noise. And this is going to be very important because all the data I'm going to use are observational data, which are full of noise. And in fact, I know some of you will try to crucify me now when I present the data, precisely because there is a lot of noise. And then try to tell you, well, even if there is a lot of noise, you can find a lot of stuff here. Now, the problem for this, however, is like if you really want to model, to write some nonlinear differential equations to model the development of the system, ideally you would want to have every single variable that's relevant for the system. And this is a kind of small problem. So there's a few things that might matter in a child's language development. There's no way we're gonna get close to this. And me not being a mathematician, I'm originally a computer scientist, I was really shocked, many of you might have known this from birth, but I didn't, when I found out about Taken's theorem, which is literally the closest thing to black magic I've ever seen. And this theorem, what it tells you, is that if you have one single of the variables of a dynamical system, for a couple of dynamical system, you can actually quite successfully recover the dynamics of the whole system with just one measure variable. And if the theorem even introduces how to recompose those dynamics, and this introduces the whole idea of attractor reconstruction or state space reconstruction. So imagine that you have a dynamical system. Here you have a classical three-variate dynamical system. So here, in fact, what you have is three-time series that are coupled, and that they are interacting with each other and influencing each other. So these three variables could be a measure of the child's language, a measure of the mother's language, and something else. But they could be anything in the system. The idea in attractor reconstruction is that if you now take a single one of those series and you plot it against itself, lacking time, see that what you recover is very much something extremely similar to the original attractor, that actually preserves many of the topological properties of the original attractor. So this is cool. This is, as I said, first time I tried it, it's like, I don't believe this, and I began trying it with different systems, and it was actually working. It's like, wow, this is magic, really magic. Because now we have opened the door for modeling systems that are enormously complex, that have many variables we don't know about, and still we can get the dynamics right. So, how do these relate to causality? And this, in recent years, from 5 years ago, in the work of George Sugihara in ecology, I like stealing things from ecologists. Working in linguistics, I feel an enormous jealousy towards the field of ecology, because they've been developing the right mathematical tools for the problems that linguists have been avoiding for years. So the nice thing about this is that I can actually steal a lot from them, and I don't have to develop my own techniques, which is cool. And in particular, I like what George Sugihara and his group have been doing. And they've been developing a technique they call convergent cross-mapping, and they've shown now repeatedly in many, many domains that you can actually use attractor space reconstruction to infer causal relationships between variables. And this brings us back to the old correlation does not imply causality or does not entail causality. And in fact, and I know several people in this room who would agree, we need to change this one and say that correlation actually does imply causality. always. So let's think about this. Imagine that you have an attractor M. This is a true attractor of our dynamic gas system before. Now, as I told you, with each single one of the variables, you can actually reconstruct the full properties of the attractor. So imagine that now you reconstruct the attractor based on X and based on Y. And you see both reconstructions contain many of the properties of the original attractor, but they are not identical, they are kind of different. The crucial thing is that each of those can be mapped to the original attractor, but also you can map directly from one shallow attractor. I call this shallow attractors are the reconstructions based on a single variable. You can directly map from one shallow to the other shallow. There's a one-to-one correspondence between the points in both reconstructions of the attractor. And now the idea of causality is based precisely on this guy. And I was thinking a lot when I learned about this technique, how to explain this to students. And I had two metaphors. But as I was telling you before, we need to say that correlation does imply causality. If two theories are correlated, we know that either A causes B, B causes A, they are in some kind of feedback loop, or there is some additional variable that is actually causing both of them. I'm not talking about numerical correlation, I'm talking about real correlations. So if the correlation is true, there is something linking those variables.
Sorry, what is true correlation as opposed to numerical correlation?
Well, a numerical correlation is when you get two series and you find that it has, say, R equal 0.6 with a p-value of 0.027.
Right.
That still, you have the probability that those things are not correlated. You just observe what looks like a correlation. A true correlation is when you would have a p of 0. When you know for sure that two things are correlated. Not, you just don't have just some evidence that they might be correlated. You know that there, if the correlation is true, the causality is true.
There's always a gradation of sureness.
Of course, but there is always a gradation of sureness, but what I'm talking is, if you want to say causation is there for sure, you can only say if correlation is there for sure. The correlations could be spurious, then there could be also spurious causation. Mm-hmm. But I'm trying to distinguish the case, saying, well, yes, some things are correlated just by chance, of course. But I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about the things that are not correlated by chance. Then there should be a causal relation.
Well, it's hard to decide.
It is hard to decide, but this is an important theoretical point, though. And we decide, as usual, using p-values, etc. But we have to keep this in mind.
So, I mean, I will just let you continue now, but...
Can we go back to this, because this is kind of a minor point, and we go back to it at the end of the thing?
Sure, why not?
Okay, so I was thinking of how to infer causality and how to explain this method in an easy way. So imagine that you're looking at the footprints in the snow of a dog and the owner. Now, typically the owner will have the dog on a leash. And in fact, you would know here, even before you look at the tracks, that's actually the movement of the owner who's guiding the movement of the dog, and not vice versa. Well, depends, some people have very big dogs. In the normal case, it's the owner that's leading the dog. Now, our task is very, very, very similar to what we're seeing here. Like, just by looking at the tracks, we have to guess who was leading. And the idea that Sugihara exploits is that when a series A crosses a series B, and if you reconstruct the attractor, both A and B will be variables in the dynamical system, and when you reconstruct the attractor based on A or based on B, you'll find that if A causes B, the attractor of A will be embedded in B's attractor. And I explain this to my students, it's like, look, if you have a guy that's moving across a room, and you want to see if somebody kicked him, or he's just moving on his own volition, what you could do is you could look for a footprint in his ass. So this is exactly the same thing. So the causing system will leave its footprint on the cause system. Therefore, if A causes B, we'll be able to find A's attractor on B, but we will not necessarily be able to find B's attractor on A's attractor using the shallow reconstructions. And this is exactly what they are doing. So what they do to prove causality is use one shallow attractor to predict the other. And if you can use this shallow attractor to predict this other one, it means that the attractor here is already contained in here. So that means that this causes this. On the other hand, there is a problem because this would be very subject to short spanning causal relationships. So for something has a small effect on something else for a short time, but it's not really driving. This is the example of the dog suddenly pulls you a little bit for 1 second and takes you off course. This would be subject to this, but then they add the issue of convergence, saying, well, in order to avoid those temporal things, so here again you see the dog and the owner, and you say, well, if blue is the owner and red is the dog, from the red attractor you can basically reconstruct the blue line, but from the blue line you cannot reconstruct the red one so accurately. This is the basic idea of causality. So when you look at a dog and an owner, you probably see tracks looking very much like this. And the idea is that you need to have this predictivity, but the predictivity has to get better the longer the series you're using. And that's the convergent part of the technique. So basically, the longer the series, the better the predictivity, and that is the final proof of that there is really causation between the series, not just a one instantaneous thing that has happened.
I have a question.
Yeah.
How is there different to things like grandeur causality, which also is like
actually
how much one time series predicts another?
Actually, that's a very important question. So I use in other works that some of you have seen, I have used gradient causality. The nice thing about this gradient causality is specifically thought for stochastic systems. So at least if you believe the theory, gradient causality would only work in systems of purely stochastic. Deterministic systems should not be subject to gradient causality. Although in my own experience I found that distinction is very fuzzy. But the more important thing is that this technique works for non-stationary systems. Gradient causality, you really need the systems to be because in gradient causality, if you find that A causes B, there is always the possibility that there is a third variable C that was responsible for the causation that you haven't measured. This possibility is discarded in this technique. So here you find that A causes B, you are sure that there is not another variable C that's actually responsible for that causation. And Tuihara has very, very nice evidence for that. So this is what makes it very powerful. You can really discard other factors being responsible for this.
I know you probably want to go on, but can you give us a hint of what is the trick for getting rid of the confounding variable?
To be honest, I'll be very, very, very honest. The math are beyond me. So I tried to go through Suihara's math on that, and I couldn't really fully understand it. I did, however, first look at his examples and simulations. They work well, and then do some myself. They had one very cool one. So they actually looked at the population of sardines and anchovies on the California coast. And when you see the series, they look like perfectly anti-correlated systems. So you have population of sardines, population of anchovies, population of sardines, population of anchovies. So they seem to be related. In fact, biologists know they are not related. Those things are driven both by the temperature of the ocean. So what seemed to be a causation between anchovies and sardines, anchovies don't eat sardines or vice versa. And the system could very, very nicely find such examples and show that there was no causal relationship in there. Not only that example, many others and many artificially designed systems. So the math is over me, but at least on the numerical simulations seem pretty convincing. I'm sorry I cannot give a better answer.
And what is the kind of information that it uses? Is it information in the sense of information theory?
Sorry?
Is this information and entropy in the sense of information theory?
You could use information theory, but what they do is much simpler. Okay. They just do a simplex prediction. You have one attractor and the other attractor. And now imagine that you have one point in this attractor. You can take the corresponding point in this attractor, take a neighborhood around it, find the mappings of those neighbors, average them, and that should be able to predict the point in the original attractor. And then you measure the correlation between your predicted and real attractor. And that's the actual measure of information that they use. But you could use it also with mutual information or any other kind of technique that you wanted to use in principle. Now, okay, so given this, I think, okay, well, now I have the techniques that I can actually, this came out of a discussion with a grad student of mine that we wanted to look at development of mother and children. It's like, well, now I have this series, I can do something about it. So the data I'm going to be using are data from the Manchester Corpus that we're developing in Elena Lieben's group in Manchester. It's a very famous data set, it's very clean and very nice. So it includes tri-weekly recordings of children playing with their mothers. They're very well labeled, and they're for a full year for 12 children, 6 boys, 6 girls. And using this data, I completed what I call macroscopic measures of development. And these are, if you've seen some of my previous work, many of these measures are measures I've been working on for a long time and nagging people about for a long time. So the measures I have is, I have a measure of lexical diversity. I'll go into these measures in a bit more detail in the next slide. But this, the lexical diversity is a measure of how many words the children knows, or the children is using, how many words the mother is using. A measure of inflectional diversity, so how many inflectional variants of each word each child is using, and how many inflectional variants of each word its mother is using. Then, some measure of syntactic diversity. And for that, I will show you in a second, I'm using mean length of utterance, which is a really stupid measure. Yes. Counting basically the average length of the sentences that the mothers or the children are using. And a measure of what they call loquacities, how much are the children speaking and how much are the mothers speaking. And of course, all of these measures are intercorrelated between them. So this is a really nice example to reconstruct a dynamical system. Now, a bit more on the measures. So for the lexical diversity, I just take the lemmatized corpus and I compute an entropy. And I adjust that entropy using the Chow, Wen, and Sheng measure. Now, for the inflectional diversity, I have proved already in many papers that these are very sensitive measures, and I'll show you the data in a second. For the inflectional diversity, take the conditional entropy of the word forms given the lemmas. So the unlemmatized forms given the lemmatized forms. And in a way, this is a measure of how much variability there is for each single lemma. And again, what I do is I decompose it into a joint entropy and a single entropy, and I estimate those separately using Chow, Wen, and Sheng. And finally, you might be a bit shocked that I'm using something as stupid as mean length of utterance as my measure of syntactic diversity. And to tell you the truth, I really didn't like that. So MLU, mean length of utterance, is the most common technique used in the language acquisition literature to measure the development of syntax, but I always thought this was very stupid and a really bad measure. We should do something better than this. It's been used since the 1920s. So what I did is, look, I wanted a real explicit measure of this diversity of syntactic structures. So I spent a few weeks actually working on it. And what I did is develop a way of generalizing an entropy of a context-free grammar to also generalize for the rules of Hein and Kerr. I was really proud of myself. It worked really well. And I used it, and then I found that it correlated at 0.99 with mean length of utterance. So, meaning, despite all my brilliant work, I have gone exactly to the same point that the language acquisition community had been using since 1920. Only that theirs was actually much easier to compute. That convinced me, okay, these guys are actually not stupid, and they are using the best available technique. I was very impressed.
Well, but now we know it. Before, we didn't know that.
Still, it was, no, I mean, for me, it feels like I've been wasting 3 weeks of my life.
No. Can I just ask,
yeah.
What's the unit of length?
The unit of length, that's actually a very good question. So the unit of length in traditional studies in language acquisition is the morpheme. However, there is quite a lot of recent work that says that that doesn't really matter. You just need to count the words and that's enough. And the results are identical. So the standard in the language acquisition community is count the number of morphemes in the utterance. In fact, if you count just the words, the results are equally good. And that, if I guess that you're looking for a technique you could use with animals, this would be, especially for instance, if you look at syllables in birds or things like that, you could work very, very well with something like that. Okay, how do the data look like? So here, the solid lines are the children, the dashed lines are their mothers, they're matched by colors, but don't try to pay much attention to the actual matching. This is the measure of loquacity, and what it's showing you is that, evidently, as the children get older, they're talking more. And you can hardly see it there, but if you do a regression analysis, you'll find that actually the mothers are also on average talking slightly more as their children get older, which makes sense. The older your baby gets, the more you talk to them. Now, when you look at lexical diversity, you find already things are very different. So what you find is that most children between 2 and 3 years are already using a lexical diversity very similar to that of their parents. And that, again, there is a slight slope in that upper part. So this upper part here has a slight increase in slope, and it's significant. And then you find that there is 2 children that are having what we call a vocabulary burst. And this is something that happens in most children, but typically it happens between 18 months and 24 months of age. These 2 children are only having it a bit later. So they're going in a very radical change, acquiring a lot of words and matching everybody else. You can already see, when you look at inflectional diversity, that those very same children are also developing their inflectional systems a bit later than the others. And when you go to their syntactic development, you find that they're actually pretty normal. Perhaps, remember they were the red and the gray lines. They're also the ones that are getting a bit later. So this seems to suggest, it's again, this is not causal evidence, this is correlational evidence, but this suggests that there is a link between the acquisition of grammar and the acquisition of the lexicon for the same specific children. Now, what happens? What can we do with convergence cross-mapping? So here what I did is I did an extension of convergent cross-mapping to actually deal with networks. So what I have is for each child and mother, I have 8 series. So lexical diversity, inflectional diversity, mean length of utterance, and loquacity for mother and for child. And now we have to reconstruct a network of causal arrows between those 8 variables. That's a lot of causal arrows to reconstruct, if you think about it. Now, if you don't take a little bit of care, you're going to get a lot of spurious p-values in there, so you really have to account for multiple comparisons in here. So what I did is first tested one thing, one precondition for being able to use convergent cross mapping is that there is actually nonlinear signaling here. And in the sense that the signals could be just purely stochastic, then this, in principle, this technique could not work. There is not a dynamical system that you could reconstruct. So what you can do is, there are several tests that have applied more than one. The simplest one is to see that there is a decrease in how well a series can predict itself into the future. The farther you go into the future, the worse it should get. That's a very clear signature of a nonlinear dynamical system. And for all of these series, you have that. Then, as we have 56 tests for 56 possible arrows in the network, you need to correct for multiple comparisons. And what I do is you get a p-value using the bootstrapping method, and then you use the false discovery rate to correct those p-values so that you don't get false correlations due to the huge number of tests. This is very important, particularly in my case, because I wanted to be very conservative, and although I had some ideas of what arrows I expected to see, to be honest, these ideas were very, very vague, so there was a lot of fishing involved in here. And therefore, I didn't have very, very clear ad hoc predictions, I really needed to correct my p-values. Now, I'm very glad I've been developing this also for Granger causality, if people are interested, and testing it, and it's extremely good at recovering full networks very, very accurately with networks I actually have generated myself, and I know the shape they should have. So let's see what happens if we consider just the child. Remember that I told you that, well, in order to learn some words, you need to know something about syntax. And in fact, what you find is that the syntactic diversity and linear patterns actually has a causal relation towards the lexical diversity. And the lexical diversity is itself influential in the development of inflectional diversity. So this is a very poor picture, it doesn't tell us much. So the cool thing is like, okay, let's bring mommy in. So when we bring mother in the picture, the first thing we find is that the lexical diversity of the mother influences both grammatical aspects of the child. So the richer the lexicon the mother is using, the richer the inflection and the syntax the child is using, and the more the child speaks. There is more, because then you also find that the more diverse the syntactic structures the mother is using, the more diverse the lexicon the child is using, and the more the child speaking. And I think even most importantly, least from the theoretical point of view, but from the practical point of view, speak to your children a lot. The loquacity of the mother influences, the more the mother speaks, influences every single aspect of the development of the language in the child. And this is actually something that fits very, very well with the evidence that people like Weisleder in Stanford have been shown. But notice that all these arrows are going up, are going from the mother to the child. I have not shown you a single arrow down. And remember that for the fine-tuning hypothesis to be true, we need the mother not only know that the children is learning language from her mother, but we need to know that the fact that the mother has simplified language is being a direct response to the child. And in fact, when you look at arrows in the other direction, you only find one arrow, the old arrow you have there. The richer the syntax of the child, the richer the syntax in the mother. So there is strong fine-tuning, but it's only happening at the highest level of structure. And it's like, why would they do that? Well, that's the only thing you need to pay attention to, because when you look at arrows within the mother, what you find is that everything else is fully connected. So if you're paying attention to your child's syntax, and you're adjusting your own language with regard to your own syntax, which already includes the child's syntax, you're already able to fine-tune the whole system. So you really want to know how much your baby knows of language, you only need to care about his syntax, and then you can do the adjustments of your own language.
What do you think of the very curious fact that none of the variables, with exception of loquacity of the mother, affect directly that of the child? Because I would say, like, I also don't have strong expectations, but I would have expected the lexical diversity of the mother to impact the child, that inflectional diversity does the same thing. And
I actually have thought about it, so actually you can see that very clearly here. So if you look at the lexical diversity, it affects everyone but lexical diversity. Mm-hmm. And if you look at syntactic diversity, it affects everyone but syntactic diversity. Mm-hmm. And I don't really have a good explanation for that. I suspect it might be a fluke of the technique. Like, it might be that the series are so correlated, in direct correlation, not in lag correlation, that it's very difficult to distinguish one direction from the other. But this is just a bet. I really don't have a good answer for that. Also, I need to say, I have now replicated this data on Hebrew and get very, very, very similar results. So it doesn't seem to be something about English. I'm beginning to think it's something probably more general. I'm going to try to do it soon for German and a few other languages, and hoping to find similar results. But at the moment, the Hebrew results are not fully finalized, so I don't fully trust them, but I'm beginning to get an indication that this might be true for many other languages. At least from one other language, sorry. Now, what are my conclusions? Well, yes, we have evidence for lexically based syntax in the sense that, yes, the syntax of the child, the grammar of the child is using, is responding to the lexical units used by the mother. And for the converse, we also know that the syntactic units used for the mother influence the knowledge of the lexicon by the child. We have evidence for strong fine-tuning, at least in syntax. Notice that all the arrows that were not there, I don't really have evidence for them not to be there. I just say I don't have sufficient evidence to claim them. But at least in terms of syntax, we can say that the child is indeed responding, that the mother is indeed responding to the grammar of her child. And I think this is very important. And as I was saying, at least in this data, it seems like the mother doesn't care about anything else. This could be either because I haven't seen it, this is possible, or because looking at the syntax is enough to get all the properties of the language. And if you only look at the loquacity, you find that there's a very powerful, that's actually the most powerful relationship. The more the mother speaks, the better everything else gets in the child. And not the other way around, by the way. So the mother is on the driving seat, and It seems like very clearly children benefit a lot from receiving, from being talked to. And this is kind of trivial if you think about it in a learning system. What we're saying here is the bigger the training sample, the better the children do. And if you look at it from a machine learning point of view, it's something you would, you should be expecting. It would be very weird that I wasn't there. I mean, if this wasn't here, I probably wouldn't trust my results. Let's put it that way. So, and I can also have more technical conclusions. The first is you can really do causal inference and observational data. You don't necessarily have to use experiments, and in many situations, experiments are just not possible. One area in which I'm also working is historical linguistics, and try to do experiments on historical linguistics, good luck. The other nice thing is that this model, the model I, the analysis technique I've been using, doesn't have a single free parameter. So you don't have to guess any parameter and put it in there. Everything is linear and straightforward how you do it.
Right. You have to decide the threshold for the false discovery rate, at least.
The false discovery rate, yes, the only thing you set is the traditional threshold p-value, the 0.05, the standard.
Yes.
But if you want, you can take that as a free parameter, but that's the only free parameter in the whole system. All the rest is fixed.
Right. How about the embedding dimension?
The embedding dimension, there is actually techniques for finding it. So basically what you want to do, you need to choose the lag and the embedding dimension. Mm-hmm. The lag, you choose the one that minimizes the mutual information between the series. And the embedding dimension, you choose the one that maximizes the predictivity in the simplex method. So both of them are fixed. And now I'm using this to, what I really want to do is do what I call a birth-to-death model of language development. Because I don't think that language acquisition is something that stops when you're two. I have also data on aging showing that people don't stop growing in vocabulary in their whole life. However, men, women don't, by the way. Stop improving their syntax at the very old age of 43, which is my age. And they actually start getting worse. And I really think you could put a single set of differential equations modeling acquisition and aging. This is my dream, of course this is science fiction at the moment, but this is where I'm trying to go. And I'm also trying to apply the causalities, because if we take causality seriously, causality should allow intervention. Meaning, if A really causes B, it means that if we manipulate A, we should change B. Now, if I find causal relations, for instance, I'm looking at this in education and particularly in Alzheimer's disease. That Alzheimer's disease has very clear linguistic footprints. If we find that we can intervene on early aspects and early markers and improve, for instance, if we know that there is a decrease in syntactic performance that is caused by a decrease in lexical performance in an Alzheimer's patient, if we do something to reinforce the lexical performance, we would prevent the syntactic decay. If intervention were not possible, I wouldn't trust any of these. This would also serve as a test for these variables. If intervention doesn't work, probably the causality I'm finding is not true. And that's it. Thank you.
So how about cases where A affects B and B affects A? So
you both
cars. But in your results, is there any case? Because
I think there are here, but in other cases I have seen double arrows. So that double arrows are clearly a possibility.
I think that here there is none. That's why
here there is none. But it's I think actually there are in the there are at the bottom. Look between inflectional diversity and loquacity.
Yeah.
In the model's language. But I mean, you should.
So
you can find both arrows.
Okay.
More questions?
Yeah. So this map shows that there is a causal relationship between the MLU of the child and MLU of the mother. But if I try to, let's say, interpret it in classical correlation terms, is it a positive correlation or anti-correlation?
Between the MLU of the child and the mother, it's a positive correlation.
Positive.
I actually should have plotted graphs. I also have the correlational plots, mm-hmm. where you can see the actual correlations, and most of these correlations, if not all, are positive.
Uh-huh.
Christian?
So, and the correlation between MLU, so the correlation between MLU and inflectional diversity and lexical diversity is probably stronger than the other way around, right?
I really haven't done, I cannot answer that question because I really, perhaps I should in fact, but I really haven't done a proper analysis of the correlation of strengths.
Yeah.
Also because in order to keep things simple, what I've done is I have normalized all variables to 0, 1.
Mm.
Because you have to think that these variables are on very different scales. So comparing the correlations, the magnitude correlation magnitude is not trivial.
Mm.
Yeah, can be done, but I should do it, but I haven't done it yet, so I can't
yeah,
really.
I was just wondering, you know, why is syntax
well,
so important here? I guess that you can't, from the syntax in your definition, from the mean length of utterance, you can predict inflectional diversity and you can predict lexical diversity, but lexical diversity can also be in theory high without having long sentences.
Imagine that you're teaching a class and you're teaching many, many, many concepts, all of which are involved in a final concept that you teach in the class. You could actually do an exam in which you only test them on that final concept, and that would be very good for knowing everything else, how well they are, the students are on everything else. My guess is that it's very much the same kind of process.
Mm.
If you know that the child is doing good at syntax at a certain level, it means already that he has acquired many other things. So in a way, going to the highest level is not a bad strategy. But on the other hand, I cannot be sure there are no others. I can only say there is this one. There might be others and I just haven't been lucky when seeing them. So if you go here, these are the actual p-values, corrected p-values, and the ones that are in bold are the significant arrows, but you see that there are several things there that are not so far from being significant. So there might be additional arrows there that I haven't plotted.
Here that it would be nice to check this correlation for different languages, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm working on at the moment.
Okay, and thank you for your presentation. Great talk and great work. I'm sure that the psycholinguists are very appreciative. I just, when you go back to your arrows, I wonder if you can, okay, you don't see a direct reciprocal causality, but you probably can see some loops here. Right?
Yes. Yeah.
And
there are loops in the graph.
Is this first of all, is this interesting? Second of all, and interpretable in terms of the language acquisition. Second of all, I have a more general question also, because I really appreciate this discovering of the structure of causality here. But on the other hand, when you talk about interaction dominant systems,
mm-hmm.
you kind of have a claim that things are often so complicated that you really cannot discover the structure, and you just see the dimensionality of the system, etc. Because the influences are non-additive, but multiplicative, and things become so complicated that sometimes you cannot discover the C, for example, the A's,
yeah.
right? So what is your strategy?
Well, my strategy in this is I've kept here a very small number of variables. There's only 4 variables for the language of the child, 4 of them for that of the model. Still, as you see, that gives you 56 possible relationships. That's already quite a lot. From what I've seen, in systems of this magnitude, you can actually reconstruct the networks fairly well. When I do it with artificial systems, it gets pretty accurate at reconstructing the original network. I suspect that, as you say, if I had, say, 100 variables for each, these series in trouble probably.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, I haven't tried it. But it's very likely that I will get in trouble.
Really good stuff, you know that I agree with all of your information, because so that's not a surprise. But I think something I would really like to see is that you mentioned that you can get rid of third variables
yeah.
as sources for causality. One direct empirical test would be, say, here you have, if you remove lexical diversity, say,
mm-hmm.
right, you will still have a spurious dependency between syntactic diversity and inflectional diversity, right? So here, it's implied that there is an indirect causal relation
yeah.
between the three, right? So if your method is kosher, then removing lexical diversity shouldn't lead to a relation
that's,
between syntactic diversity and inflectional diversity.
That's correct, I should try that. Thank
so
you.
That would be it.
Thank you, that's a really good suggestion. Yes?
Would you expect the same arrows for second language teaching?
I have no idea, but in principle, no. I think the processes that are going on there are actually fundamentally different. But I don't know.
It doesn't make sense to record language classes on Friday.
I think it could be relatively easily done, especially since there is large like databases in that case. But I have no reason to expect it to be the same. What I'm hoping is at least that the same is across languages. And if there are differences, I hope those differences are interesting. But I can't say very little at the moment on that. This is the first time I work on language acquisition, so.
Okay, there are no questions.
Thank you.
So let's.